When thinking about American history, we often get our timelines confused. One might think that one day Columbus discovered the New World and the next day the Pilgrims were stepping onto Plymouth Rock. Well, not exactly. Some 60 years after Columbus left, the French arrived and established a colony called Fort Caroline near modern-day Jacksonville, Florida. A year later, 1565, Spain created a place down the road called St. Augustine. We know that eventually the British would dominate the settlement of our eastern seaboard, but it was still another 40 years before they finally had some relative success with the establishment of Jamestown, Virginia in 1606. And keep in mind, that was 100 years after Columbus's last visit. The beginning of larger scale settlement was yet another 15 years away, as between 1622 and 1673, Massachusetts saw the establishment of 62 towns. That early Jamestown colonial effort was called the Virginia Company of London. It was a business enterprise, bringing Englishmen across the pond. At first, all the land in the colony was owned by the company. The colonists were like sharecroppers. After a while, the company figured that folks would work harder if they could own their own land and allowed private property. An interesting footnote, in 1620, in an effort to create a more stable society, the company brought from England a boatload of marriageable young women. The price was 120 pounds of tobacco for each bride. But a more significant footnote is that the owners of the Virginia Company decided the colony might be more successful if the settlers had some say in the governing of things. And in 1619, they created the Virginia House of Burgesses, the very first elected legislative assembly in the New World. As the various colonies were created, each of them eventually established their own legislative body. Keep in mind that in those days, the right to vote or hold office was limited to men who owned property. So in the 1600s, we see three main European countries vying for a foothold and ultimately control of the New World: the British, the Spanish, and the French. And of course, there were the Native Americans who, from the European perspective, mostly didn't count.
It's interesting, there were really three main groups who colonized in North America. We have the English, and we have the French, and the Spanish. And they all had different attitudes towards their treatment of the natives. Let's take the English first. Theirs was push them back, exterminate them, send them to slave camp, slave labor in the Indies and things like this. But they did not mingle with them. They just kept pushing them back. Eventually, the Americans would inherit a lot of that and to moving them to reservations. The British did not intermarry with the Indians as a rule. Let's just say usually, most of the time. But the French, now the French were different. They were not really colonizers. They were the coureurs de bois, the runners of the woods. They were trappers and traders, and they actually didn't infringe on the Indians' life nearly as much as the British or the Spanish did. And so you might say that the French were the best liked by the natives in North America. The Spanish were totally different in that they intermarried, but they had such a strict class system. Their caste system was so strong that if you had Indian blood in you, you were always a lower level. And they did intermarry. They shared their culture through religion. They shared their language, their music, their art, their architecture. They shared the horse, brought the horse in. And what I liked best, they introduced the guitar this part of the country. But the Spanish contributions really, I think, to the natives. But by intermarrying with them, and they served in the Spanish military and so forth. So there was a whole lot more intermingling with the through the Spanish than there was with any of the others who came into North America.
In the course of studying and researching this program, a couple of topics jump out as conflicts that seem almost never ending. I think the modern expression is the elephant in the room, meaning the thing everyone is aware of but no one wants to mention. We've already mentioned religious conflict, but the larger, longer-lasting issue is slavery. So how did slavery in America begin? When did the first slaves arrive? It had its origin with the first English colonization of North America in Virginia around 1607, although it is reported that African slaves were brought to Spanish Florida as early as the 1560s. Most slaves were black and were held by whites, although some Native Americans and free blacks also held slaves. It is said that there were also a small number of white slaves, although we have not confirmed that. So we jump back across the pond in 1688 and find that they once again had a Catholic monarch, King James II. He was particularly unpopular with members of Parliament, who in the third year of James's reign joined forces with a Dutch army to organize a revolution. An invasion was mounted, and in fairly quick order, he was sent packing into exile. Later, this became known as the Glorious Revolution. What's interesting, but not uncommon in that time and place, is that the revolution was planned and its army led by a fellow called William of Orange and his wife, Mary, who just happened to be King James's own daughter and her husband, who were, of course, Protestants. Aside from religion, there were other reasons why James II was disliked by the Parliament. James was a big fan of an old concept called the divine right of kings. That view believed that God gave the king the absolute right to do whatever he wanted. In short, it was as if the king was God, and everyone else, particularly the pesky members of Parliament, had no authority to disagree with him. Remember, this was 450 years after the Magna Carta, and the people, especially members of Parliament, had long come to believe that they did have some rights. Well, after the Glorious Revolution, with the blessing of Parliament, William and Mary became King William III and Queen Mary II, jointly holding the monarchy. But this arrangement required their agreement to an Act of Parliament called the English Bill of Rights, a phrase later borrowed by the United States. And the document itself was written in a format that was later partially borrowed by Thomas Jefferson in writing the Declaration of Independence. The first half of the document is a long list of complaints about the bad things King James II had done. Paraphrasing in more modern English, some of the complaints included, he has prosecuted people for merely complaining about things. He has levied taxes for his personal use without the approval of Parliament. He has, in time of peace, raised and paid a standing army and forced citizens to house and feed them without approval of Parliament. He has disarmed good Protestant citizens while giving arms and employment to Catholics. He has interfered with free elections, demanded excessive bail, illegal and cruel punishments have been inflicted, and he has required court defendants to pay fines and forfeitures before they were even convicted of anything. Sound familiar? Those are some of the specifics, but the most important impact is that it once and for all established that the real power rested with the Parliament, not the king. The second half of the English Bill of Rights goes back through those abuses and declares them all illegal from that point forward. As positive as those reforms were, there was another side to the story. For the next more than 100 years under English law, Roman Catholics could not purchase land, nor hold public office, nor seats in Parliament. They could not inherit property or practice their religion without incurring civil penalties, and Catholics could not own a firearm.